All right. Thank you for joining us today. Go ahead and get started. I'm Dan Larkin. I'm a researcher with MACIRC and the Department of Fisheries, Wildlife, and Conservation Biology at University of Minnesota. And I am pleased to introduce Wes Glisson, who's a researcher in my lab, who will be presenting an analysis of treatment outcomes to advance starry stonewort management. We should have a good amount of time for Q&A before we let you go a little bit before two today. You can enter any questions you have in the chat and I'll be sort of reviewing that and moderating it. So without further ado, I will mute myself and turn it over to Wes.
All right, thanks so much, Dan, for that introduction. As Dan mentioned, this is a project that him and I have been spearheading, but kind of before I really get into it, I want to mention all the collaborators and contributors to this project, a number of which might be here in this audience. So folks from the Departments of Natural Resources from Minnesota, Indiana, and Wisconsin, as well as a number of private contractors and other folks who have helped us out with this project tremendously. So really, this is a talk that is composed of a lot of folks coming all together to help out. Looks like I'm a little slow on my slide progression here, but there we go. So many folks are probably already aware of starry stoneworts and this species, but just to give a quick background, starry stonewort, or Nidolopsis obtusa for the scientific name, it's a large growth green macroalga. So it's an algae, but it grows like a plant and has plant-like structures. It's originally native to Europe and Asia. The first record was about 45 years ago, in 1974, in North America along the St. Lawrence Seaway near, in New York. And it's currently in 8 states. So since that time, it's spread to quite a few states, especially within the past 10 to 15 years. So in regards to impacts, this is mostly what we focus on when we think of starry stonewort. We know that it produces substantial biomass and tall, dense beds, and these dense beds can fill up the water column. As a result, we know that starry stonewort can hinder recreation. So whether it's boating, swimming, fishing, those tall, dense beds really get in the way of enjoying the lake. Just as a quick example, the photo down here on the screen is me and a coworker and fellow lab mates holding up a rake of starry stoneworts. You can just see how much biomass is produced by starry stoneworts. There's also been some evidence that it reduces the native macrophyte abundance and richness. Some other folks have been studying this, as well as folks in our lab, which has been looking on this on Lake Coronis. So as you can imagine, because of these impacts, there's been a lot of attempts to manage starry stoneworts, particularly here in the upper Midwest. Typical strategies have included algicide treatments. So these are typically copper-based. I have Q-Train Plus in there as an example, and I'll mention a couple other of these copper-based products that have been used to control starry stonewort. Other strategies include physical removal, so hand pulling or mechanical harvesting. And there's been a lot of anecdotal reports on treatment effectiveness. There's been some success with small-scale control, but there's been overall mixed results. And one thing that folks note is that year after year, there's been regrowth. So I presented on a study that we'd done with some collaborators on Lake Coronis. I presented this at the showcase a couple years back. This work was published a couple years back as well, where we actually looked at the effects of treatment on Lake Coronis. And what we found was that algicide treatments and combinations of mechanical plus algicide treatments were pretty effective at reducing biomass on Lake Coronis. Again, this is work I presented on before. But folks are familiar with those presentations. I've used this slide a couple of times just to reiterate that those results are from one lake in 1 year with limited replication on that lake. And really we need to repeat those kinds of studies that we did on Coronis over many lakes and many years. Luckily, or not so luckily, if you're worried about starry stoneworts infestation and invasion here, we have lots of lakes and lots of years worth of data. So specifically for this talk, I'm going to be focusing on 3 states, Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Indiana. And these states really represent a kind of a Western invasion front of starry stoneworts. They're also states that are relatively recently invaded, so they really provide a prime opportunity to study starry stoneworts, treatment efforts, as well as help prevent starry stonewort spread both within these lakes and to further states further west. So here I just have for each state the year of first infestation, first known infestation rather, as well as the current number of water bodies. And as you can imagine, these change. I just included one new recent lake that was found in Minnesota, now up to 15. And as I mentioned before, we have lots of data, both from surveys done on starry stonewort infested lakes and treatments conducted on those lakes. And what this project did was bring together those data and synthesize them so that we can actually get information on how effective treatments were. So in regards to project goals, we had two main goals. The first one was to compile data on starry stonewort treatments and surveys, so just as I mentioned. And just to kind of see where we're at with that data, what kind of treatments are being done, what kind of survey data do we have? Next, kind of the meat of the talk will come in will be the evaluating the effectiveness of those treatments for starry stonewort control. And we'll focus on two areas, first being multi-year data, so the effects of those treatments over multiple years, and then within-year data. So I'm going to start with, again, our data compilation process and what kind of data we came up with. So we worked, as I mentioned, with those different departments of natural resources from Minnesota, Wisconsin, Indiana, as well as private contractors to get basically any and all available treatment data and survey data from infested lakes. Treatment data came in a couple of different styles, so pesticide application records, which we're familiar with here in Minnesota, and then a couple other types, as well as just information provided directly from those collaborators. In regards to survey data, we got raw survey data, so just spreadsheets that were sent to us from DNR personnel, as well as some summary data, so data from point intercept surveys that's already been summarized and kind of synthesized for us. So in regards to treatment data, here's a breakdown of the treatment data we received. So we received data from a total of nearly 400 treatments. So an individual treatment would be just a treatment event in a given year on a given lake. And as you can see from this graph, the vast majority of those treatments were algicide treatments. So the analysis I'm going to be presenting on is, aside from some things I'm going to show at the end of the talk, is specifically going to be focused on these algicide treatments. As you can see, there's a couple other treatment types, hand pulling, mechanical harvest, DASH, that stands for diver-assisted suction harvesting, that have also been implemented to a lesser degree. Also mentioned that the majority of these algicide treatments are copper-based, and my next slide, I'll present some of those different copper-based algicides that have been used. And what this amounts to across all the lakes for the data that we have is about 20 tons of elemental copper that has been used to treat starry stonewort on those lakes. So quite a lot of copper is being used. So here's a breakdown of some of the most frequently used algicides and algicide combinations. So the topmost being combinations of Cutrien Ultra and Hydrothal 191. And then what I've included in this table is just ones that made up 1% or more of our data. So I want to make note that there's an additional 21 either single herbicides or herbicide combinations that made up less than 1% of our data. And again, folks familiar with treating starry stonewort will recognize some of these names: Cutrien Ultra, Cutrien Plus, Clipper, Comine, Captain. But again, the overwhelming majority of treatments were conducted with combinations of Cutrien Ultra and that Hydrothal 191. So in regards to survey data, this will be important. We got survey data, really three different types of survey data. So the first being whole lake PI surveys, which will represent kind of the whole lake response to treatment for starry stoneworts. Again, this is from PI surveys or point intercept surveys where a grid was set across the lake in the littoral zone. And then each of those points along the grid are sampled for the occurrence of starry stonewort. We also got data from these targeted sub-PI surveys. And this is a way to assess the response of starry stonewort within specific treated areas. So this is what that black box represents. Lastly, we got data on case studies. So for the majority of these, we have a treated area and actually an untreated reference area. So we can compare these two areas over time. These case studies also typically involve biomass monitoring, which is a little bit different than what you collect on your standard PI survey. And I just want to mention that there's really a gradient here of both spatial scale and available data. So we have a lot of data from these whole like PI surveys on down to these case studies where we have very little available data, but that spatial scale is going to be much smaller. So again, so we've talked about now our first goal, which was the compilation of the data, and now I'm going to get into how we evaluated the effectiveness of those treatments. I'm going to start off with this. I'm going to start off with the multi-year data, but I want to dive into those whole API surveys and what that data actually looked like. So for that whole lake data, we data from a total of 35 lakes, and I have the breakdown here by state. Those data spanned 10 years from 2010 to 2019. This represents 150 total surveys and 109 lake years. So lake year would represent a given survey in a given year on a lake. And in this data, I kind of alluded to this, but we really have two types of data. So we have frequency of occurrence, which is just whether or not starry stonewort occurred at a given point in the survey. And then for a whole lake, you'd have a value between 0 and 1 as a proportion or percent. And then also rake density, and this is a measure of abundance. So this is a scale from 1 being the lowest abundance, which might just be a fragment of starry stonewort, up to 3, which would mean that your rake sample or whatever sampling device you used is fully covered with starry stonewort. So that 3 being the largest amount. So as I mentioned, I'm going to go into that multi-year data. And now here, before I put up the data on this graph, I want to orient folks to the axis here. Here we're going to be looking at frequency of occurrence of starry stonewort. Again, the scale is going to go from 0 to 1. And then on the bottom axis here, I have years since infested. And I will mention that each lake is going to have a different color and different line for this data. I don't won't mention specific lakes, but you'll be able to get a gist for what this looks like. So what I'm going to show is what's happening with starry stonewort frequency of occurrence over time since lakes were first infested. And this is what we see. As you can see clearly from this graph, the frequency of the starry stonewort is increasing over time in lakes since the time of first infestation for the majority of lakes. As you look at this, you're probably going to notice this one line in the middle of the graph that really has an opposite trend of what we're seeing for most of the other lakes. And this lake is Pike Lake in Wisconsin. This is our only untreated lake with greater than 2 years of survey data. And as you can see, it has a declining trend. So among, again, the lakes that have multiple years of data, this is the only one with over 2 years that has not been treated. There's one other lake that I'll mention on here that we have data for. This is Lake Winnebogoshish here in Minnesota. This is our only other untreated lake, and this just has 2 years of data. So as you can see, the majority of what we're seeing is starry stonewort increasing over time in lakes where we're treating multiple times. So for the rest of the talk, I'm going to focus on this within-year data. So just to orient you to what our data looks like, this is a hypothetical figure here. So each one of these on the vertical axis represents a given lake year. This is, again, hypothetical data. And this is what our data might look like for a given lake year. So this would be the ideal situation where we have data from a survey conducted early in the season, then a treatment was conducted, and then we have another survey that was conducted later in the season. Again, this is the ideal scenario. But we might also get data that looks like this, data from a survey that was conducted after treatment, but no pre-treatment survey. We might also get data from a lake that wasn't treated in a given year. And lastly, this scenario, so where we have data from a PI survey, and then there's a treatment, and we don't have data from a survey that was conducted after that treatment. So altogether, all this survey data makes up, as I mentioned, those numbers I mentioned in the last slide, 150 surveys, 109 lake years. But if we just want to look at this specific kind of ideal scenario where we have a before and after survey, we have fewer data points, but still a good amount of data. So data from 58 surveys. And I'm actually just going to present our results from this scenario highlighted in the black box, but want to make sure that everyone knows that these results were the same whether we analyzed all the data or just the smaller subset of data with the ideal scenario. Again, so what we did is we reduced our data set to just include these kind of surveys, and we have paired before and after surveys for each lake. And I'll reiterate again, these are whole lake PI surveys. So for those folks interested in kind of the specs of our analysis, we ran a generalized linear mixed effects model. Our response, I'm going to be presenting results from those two responses that I mentioned earlier, so frequency of occurrence and rate density. We had one predictor in these models, so that was treatment, and we're going to be looking at what happened, frequency of starry stonewort occurrence and rake density before and after treatments. We also included a grouping variable to group by lake year. Again, if you're interested in the details of the modeling process, I'd be happy to talk with you after the talk here today. So all right, here's what we found. I'm gonna bring up the data here in a second, but I wanted to orient folks to the graph here. So our response is frequency of starry stonewort occurrence. Again, the whole scale would go from 0 to 1. And then we have, again, before and after treatment. And here's what we found. So what we found is that starry stonewort frequency of occurrence is actually greater after treatment compared to before treatment. And this result was significant. For folks who might not be familiar with these box and whisker plots, the black line in the middle of the plot represents the median of the data. The box represents essentially the bulk of the data, and then with these whiskers extending to the extents of the data. So as you can see, the majority of the data for frequency of occurrence after those treatments is greater than frequency of starry stonewort occurrence before those treatments. So we also looked at rake density. Again, this is our measure of abundance. So this is on a scale from 1 to 3. Again, we looked at starry stonewort rake density before and after treatments. We saw a very similar result to our results with frequency of occurrence. Starry stonewort had a greater abundance after treatments compared to before, and this result was significant. So now that we've looked at that whole lake response or from our whole lake PI surveys, we wanted to hone in on these targeted sub-PI surveys and look at the responses just within those treated areas. So that data is a little bit smaller data set, as I mentioned earlier. So we had data from 15 lakes, 122 surveys. Again, we have both frequency of occurrence and rake density data. I have this little picture just to show you, folks who are familiar with doing some of these targeted sub-PI surveys will be familiar with what this data looks like, but I just wanna bring everyone up to speed and mention how we treated the data to be able to do our analysis. So this is a scenario you might see in a targeted sub-PI area where you do a couple surveys before you treat, do your treatments, do a follow-up survey, maybe there's another late season treatment, and then another survey at the end of the season. And for any one specific area, this is really great to have these data, but when we wanna compare across lakes and across lake years, we wanted to make all the data relatively similar to be able to analyze it. So what we did is we just used these surveys that were conducted before and after the first treatment efforts in that lake year. And I will mention too, before I bring up the results, is that we did a very similar analysis to what we did with this whole lake PI survey data. Again, this graph, we're looking at frequency of starry stonewort occurrence, and again, before and after treatment. And here's what we found. As you can see, there is a slightly less frequency of occurrence afterwards, after treatments, but that those error bars substantially overlap, essentially meaning that there's no difference between frequency of occurrence before and after treatment in those sub-PI surveys. And you can see our non-significant p-value demonstrates that. Now looking at rake density, again, our measure of abundance, that's our response here. Again, looking at before and after treatments, we see a very similar result. Little to no difference between between rake density before and after those treatments. Okay, folks might be scratching their heads at this point. Are these treatments really ineffective? Is that really what's going on here? There's one thing that we certainly know from our analysis so far is that we do not appear to be reducing starry stonewort below pretreatment levels. So that's pretty clear from what we've done so far. What is a little less clear is whether there'd be even more starry stonewort in a lake if we didn't treat at all. Are we keeping those levels about the same as pretreatment levels? Is that a win? Is that success? And so this is kind of the scenario that we might expect, which is that throughout the season, starry stonewort is going to be growing up. It's going to be producing more biomass. It's going to maybe be spreading throughout the lake throughout the season. It's going to be growing over time within a growing season. So, but what we don't know, again, is whether our treatments here represented by this blast of orange here, again, are keeping those levels low compared to what would be naturally occurring. And what we really need to be able to pick these apart would be untreated control lakes or control areas within lakes that we can monitor over time. And luckily, we have some data like that from these case studies. And I'm going to get into a couple of these moving forward here. So what makes some of these case studies special is that they, again, have this treated area that they can compare to an untreated area over time. And this is what we call before-after control impact design, or a BACI design. You don't have to remember that, but I'll kind of walk you through what that looks like. So again, you can think of this time through time in one season. And we have a before survey done in a treated area that's represented by the black box here, and an untreated area, which is represented by the gray box here. Then we'll have a treatment that's conducted, again, just in that designated treatment area. And lastly, you conduct a survey afterwards, again, in both those two areas. Hopefully this is what you'd see, where you have reduced starry stonewort in that area that you treated. But again, this can really help us tease apart what is going on naturally in the lake versus what is going on in the area that we're treating. So as I mentioned before, we've done a lot of work with the folks on Lake Coronis, and that's what I'm gonna use as my case study here. Just to give you some background for those folks who might not be familiar, Lake Coronis is near Painesville, Minnesota. Again, this is where the first known occurrence of starry stonewort was in the state of Minnesota. Lake Coronis is a fairly large lake, around 3,000 acres. And the initial infestation was about 250 acres, so there was quite a large infestation at the time it was found. Since that time, there's been a number of treatments that have been conducted on the lake, and these are a combination of algicide treatments and mechanical harvesting treatments. So again, as I mentioned before, this we had an untreated reference area on Lake Coronis. And you can see in this figure here, down on the lower right side here, and there was a BACI design that was implemented for this. So we were able to track areas that were treated against areas that were untreated. The data I'll be presenting are biomass data, and this was collected by the Coronis Lake Association in conjunction with Blue Water Science, as well as by the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources. So I'm going to be showing some data here from 2017, again on Lake Coronis, and here our response is not going to be biomass. So these are going to be repeat biomass surveys that were conducted over time throughout the season. And I'm going to be presenting those biomass results from two different areas here. So one that received an algicide treatment and an untreated reference area. So in this year, there was an initial treatment early in the season in June in that algicide area. And what you can see from this is that tracked over time, that early season treatment did not appear to be very effective at keeping that biomass low compared to the untreated reference area. You can see by August, that biomass is about the same. But a later season treatment was conducted, and that dropped biomass to next to nothing and kept that biomass low throughout the remainder of the season. And as you can see, when we have this untreated reference area to look at, we can see that the biomass naturally increased throughout the season and then leveled out. And so you can imagine from this scenario, if we had just done a survey in June and then a survey in September, we might not be able to distinguish, again, just in that algicide area, we might not be able to tell that we really had a successful treatment. So this is both to reiterate that those untreated reference areas are very important and to show that in regards to biomass or what we might consider nuisance control, these treatments can be effective. So you might be asking yourself, well, what about the other types of treatments? So far, we've mainly focused on those algicide treatments, but if you remember my pie chart that I showed earlier, there's also some treatments that were conducted by hand pull and mechanical harvest. And I'm gonna focus on those in the next couple of slides here. So I'll bring up another case study. This is Grand Lake, Minnesota. Starry stonewort was discovered here near the boat landing in 2017 during Starry Trek, which I hope folks are familiar with, but it's a statewide search for starry stonewort conducted by volunteers. Starry stonewort was limited to near the public access. So the DNR conducted several snorkel searches and found several patches of starry stonewort near that public access of varying sizes. And this figure just kind of shows where some of those patches were. And since its discovery, there has been repeat hand pull events, again, from 2017, actually to present day, the data I'll show is from 20 through 2019, and no algicide treatments were conducted on this lake or at the landing here. So I'm going to show some results from those hand pull treatments. So we have biomass as our response variable, but it's a little bit different than what I showed for Coronis. This is actually going to be biomass removed. So this is going to be the amount of biomass that was removed by the divers or snorkelers at each event. So we'll start with the 2017 data. And what we can see is that the first time that the divers went out, they removed a lot of biomass, so near 450 grams. That was in midsummer. They came back later in the summer, early fall, and again did another removal, but found substantially less biomass there. So when we look forward, you might expect, okay, is the starry stonewort going to rebound? Is this effect management style going to be effective over time? And what we can see is that the short answer is yes. So in each subsequent year, there was less starry stonewort found early in the summer, and then with subsequent removals that declined further and further. Until 2019, we received barely any biomass was even found on those initial surveys in the summer. So this is just a highlight that this hand pulling strategy can be very effective, particularly when you have a small infestation that can be discovered and removed. So we're going to travel back to Lake Coronis, and I want to highlight one more management strategy, and this is mechanical harvesting, which I had not yet mentioned before, but there's a couple areas, again, where we did both where a mechanical harvest and an algicide treatment was done, and then just where a mechanical harvest was done, and I'm going to highlight some of those results here. So okay, here we have data from 2017. Our response is biomass. And I have two areas that I'm going to highlight here, both an untreated reference area and an area that received a mechanical harvest. And what we see is that initially that mechanical harvest actually kept biomass levels relatively low, particularly compared to that untreated reference area. You can see that by August, biomass was substantially lower than that untreated reference area. But subsequent monitoring showed that biomass actually began to increase again after that mechanical harvest ended. Again, had a similar trajectory to that untreated reference area. So this can show us that mechanical harvesting can have short-term results, but they may not be long-term within a season. So highlight another scenario where mechanical harvesting was combined with algicide treatments. We're going to go back here to 2016 in Lake Coronis. Again, we're looking at biomass. And what we see is that initial mechanical harvest dropped biomass levels relatively low compared to that untreated reference. And then subsequent algicide treatments kept that biomass low compared to the untreated reference. So these combination of treatments was able to reduce biomass compared to reference levels and keep that biomass relatively low. All right, I know it's a lot of information, so I want to just give an overview of everything we've seen here, an overview of the key findings. So first of all, for those whole lake PI surveys, or when we're looking at a whole lake response, we can see that population extent is significantly increasing over time in infested lakes. So if you recall this figure here, we also see that current treatment practices don't appear to be effective at reducing the frequency of occurrence or abundance of starry stonewort on lakes. In regards to those sub-PI surveys, or those targeted treatment areas, to recall these figures, we found that frequency of occurrence and abundance remain largely the same following treatment. And lastly, in regards to these case studies, we found that treatments actually can be effective at reducing biomass for nuisance control. But as we learned, timing is also important. So some of those early season treatments may not be as effective as later season treatments in keeping that biomass down. We also showed that physical removal by hand pulling can be really effective at reducing biomass. So again, that's hand pull for those small infestations. And we also learned that combinations of mechanical harvesting and algicide treatments can be effective as well. In regards to recommendations, first of all, I'll start with monitoring recommendations. So one thing that I think I hit pretty good is that, you know, it's really important, if possible, to include an untreated reference area within a lake. This might not fit for all situations. The situation on Grand Lake, where there's a small infestation, where the whole infestation could be targeted, that might be a situation where you might not need an untreated reference area if you can go and target all the starry stoneworts. But in areas, you know, such as Coronis, it's really beneficial to have a reference area that you can monitor over time to see how effective you can be in the areas that you're treating. Again, if possible, it would be best to keep this area the same over time. Again, some management scenarios might not allow for this. And then to extend that a little bit further, folks should consider not treating, but rather just monitoring some infested lakes. So you can think of that pike lake in Wisconsin, where it's been monitored year after year since stonewort was first found there. And these lakes can be used as reference lakes that can be monitored over time, and we can compare treated lakes to these reference lakes. Lastly, I just want to mention that, you know, if possible, if feasible, measuring biomass can actually be really effective. And I understand that this is not something that could be done on a whole lake level, but in some of these targeted areas, biomass might be more accurate than things like rake density as a measure of abundance. So just quickly, you can see from these two rake samples, these would most likely be listed as a 3 as a rake density estimate, but there's probably about double the biomass in that rake on the right compared to the rake on the left. So that could just be another important consideration when monitoring. In regards to management, a couple recommendations. So first and foremost, as with any aquatic invasive species, preventing spread is crucial. And if this graph doesn't exemplify that, I'm not sure what does. So, you know, we know that once starry stonewort gets into a lake, regardless of management, or rather even with management, frequency of occurrence increases year after year. So what's most important is to just not let starry stonewort get into a lake. Again, results have shown that if found early and it's isolated, hand pulling appears to be a promising strategy for removing starry stonewort. And we also found that for these targeted areas, nuisance control can be achieved with algicide treatment, as well as combinations of mechanical harvesting plus algicide treatment. So again, the results in Lake Corona showed that these treatments can be effective in those small areas. But for very large established populations, we really need to have realistic expectations. So reducing the extent of starry stonewort within a lake is unlikely. And this graph is similar to the one that I just showed you, except that all those lines for all those lakes are kind of summed up in one line. And again, you can see that in years since infested, even if there's been multiple treatments or treatments each year, frequency of occurrence is increasing in lakes that are infested with starry stoneworts. And this is in contrast to some other aquatic invasive plant species that have been studied, such as curly leaf pondweed. So this figure here is from a paper just published this year by labmate Mike Verhoeven, as well as some co-authors, that shows that with consecutive years of treatment, you can actually reduce the frequency of occurrence of curly leaf pondweed. So again, this could be seen as a optimistic scenario. But again, unfortunately, this is not what we're seeing for starry stoneworts. So with that, I'm sure there's lots of questions. And I'll open it up to that, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Great. Thanks, Wes, and thanks everybody for listening today. We're starting to get questions in the chat, so please, if you have any questions, drop them in the chat, and I'll moderate and get through as many as we can. So first off, Wes, you were talking about these whole lake responses. Now, were those whole lake treatments of starry stonewort, or were they smaller scale treatments and looking at, you know, sort of the whole lake frequency of occurrence?
Yeah, that's an excellent question and a good clarification. So the majority of those treatments were not whole lake treatments. So they were treatments in smaller areas, but what we were looking at again is just whether those treatments were helping to control starry stonewort on a whole lake level. So, but typically those are not whole lake treatments like we might see for something like curly leaf pondweed or some of these other species.
Great, thanks. And then there was a question from somebody who lives on a lake where they use a weed harvester for non-invasive weeds, have done so for a long time. And this person was asking if mechanical harvesting might actually be, could spread the starry stonewort around by spreading bulbs around.
Yeah, that's an excellent question. You know, unfortunately, there hasn't been a lot of research in regards to starry stonewort on that particular issue. But just from our knowledge of other aquatic invasive plants, that is certainly a concern. So we know that starry stonewort can reproduce from an individual bulb, which is very tiny, as well as the nodes along the stem. So all you need is one little node, and if that's being churned up or cut up, it can be transported to other parts of the lake. So that definitely is something that should be taken into consideration, and I think a concern for mechanical harvesting. So, you know, if you have an isolated infestation, you know, you might want to look to other management strategies or other things to do aside from mechanical harvesting.
Great. What about continued use of copper-based algaecide? So if that's used annually for nuisance control, is there concern about possible long-term buildup of copper, and could that have toxicity concerns for fish or other animals?
Yeah, that's a great question, and one that I think every time I've talked about this with folks or given a similar talk, it has been brought up. And it's an area of active research or recent research, and I think a really important question. I think the short answer is we really don't know, but I think it is something to be concerned about. You know, copper, at least the dosages that are typically used to treat starry stoneworts, things like zebra mussels too, are fairly low, and in terms of the actual, you know, water quality on the day of treatment or following thereafter are fairly safe. But there really isn't a lot of work that's been done on what happens year after year after year of that copper building up. So I think it's something that folks should be looking into, and we really need to look into to know what's going on over time.
Yeah, and I'll just add to that, you know, the formulation of copper that's used is important. So for these products that are being used for starry stonewort are chelated copper compounds, which have less acute toxicity and some lower non-target concerns than copper sulfate, for example, which is used has been used for nuisance algae control and swimmer's itch. So not to say that it isn't a potential concern, and, you know, the copper can persist, but also the formulations can vary a lot in toxicity. So, somebody asked about phenology and ecology studies, and I'll take that one. We have monitored phenology. Ranjan Krishnan, who was previously in my lab and is now at Indiana University, has been involved in that work as well and has continued with it. So we have phenology data from Lake Coronis and Moose Lake up in Beltrami County, a couple years of data, and we see some strong seasonality. This is, you know, an annual species, and so we see a big ramp up of biomass through the spring and then sort of a peak in late summer and then a senescence. So that's work that we'll be working on and hopefully getting out in the not too distant future. And then as far as ecological impacts, Carly Wagner, who is now with Minnesota DNR, but is wrapping up a master's in my lab, looked at plant community impacts on Coronis, Moose, and Winnebogoshish, and found some pretty strong evidence of starry stonewort displacing native plants, and also showed you know, year-to-year spread. So sort of that there is potential for it to spread rapidly and for native plant diversity to decline with that spread. There was a question about how biomass was measured. Are these wet weights or dry weights? And then a follow-up question was whether there's been nutrient analysis of starry stonewort to look at whether there's phosphorus or other nutrient removal capabilities that could benefit water quality.
Gotcha. I'm kind of blanking on this. In terms of the wet versus dry weights, because we've done so many different things. So for our phenology work, we've been working with wet weights. But I want to actually say that the work on Coronis was actually dried weights. So those were starry stonewort that had been brought back and dried out for a couple weeks, actually. So despite how large they are, those I believe were still dry weights that we showed the results from. And then in terms of, Dan, could you just repeat the second part for me real quick?
Oh, there was a question about whether starry stonewort could be removing phosphorus or other nutrients, maybe providing a water quality benefit.
Yeah, you know, I know there's been evidence of that and work on that with other charophytes, and particularly in starry stonewort's native range. I don't think there's been much work here on that issue. But I think that, you know, generally charophytes are, you know, can increase water clarity and things of that nature. But again, I don't believe that there's been much work on that here in its invaded range. And Dan, maybe you can speak to that some more too.
Yeah, I would agree. I think that's a good summary.
Okay.
We have an update from Jim Bartlemy on Carnelian Lake, which was a starry stonewort discovery this summer. The first hand pull was conducted there last Friday. It was confined to the access area and 1,200 pounds were removed, and they have a copper treatment plan there. And for comparison, the first pull of Grand Lake yielded 350 pounds that were harvested. There's a question about that. Is the hand harvesting a suction system or actual hand pulling? And it is, when we say hand pulling, we mean actual hand pulling. There's also, as Wes mentioned, DASH, diver assisted suction harvesting. And that's when you basically have, you know, a giant underwater shop vac. And again, there it is actually hand pulling, and then it's going into this suction device to suck it up. You can't, you know, it's frowned upon to disturb a lake bottom, and that would require special permitting and oversight. So when this DASH method is used, it is not, or at least should not be the case that people are actually sort of suctioning up sediment that would have bubbles and whatnot. There's a question about concentration exposure time of chemicals within test plots. Wes might be able to add more to this. I know there has been concentration monitoring associated with some of the treatments in Minnesota, I know at least. And one of the challenges, as is common with you know, aquatic plant management, is that it can be difficult to maintain the lethal concentrations. And in particular, if you have a lot of starry stonewort, there's going to be a lot of uptake quickly that will then lower the concentration in the water of the copper.
And I'll just add, there's been quite a bit of concentration monitoring done, both in Minnesota and Wisconsin. And I know that there's been some success with keeping concentrations higher when folks have used like water barriers. So, you know, for small isolated patches or near a boat landing, they've been able to keep those concentrations a little bit higher. I don't know if those have always resulted in greater success of the treatments, but I know that, that's one way that folks have been able to keep those concentrations at a higher level. But just to add also to what Dan said, you know, that's an issue, you know, as many folks know, with any aquatic plant treatment, keeping those concentrations where you want them. So I don't think that's an issue necessarily specific to starry stonewort.
Yeah. There was a question about a graph that showed results of harvesting combined with algicide, and that even for the area with no harvesting and no treatment, that also declined significantly late in the season. And that gets back to the phenology and kind of the annual life cycle of starry stonewort. So there is, in untreated areas, as days get shorter and water temperatures cool, a natural dieback. And that's why it's really critical to, really valuable when we do have untreated reference areas that are being measured, so that you can separate out the effect of whatever treatment you're applying from just the background phenology or seasonal variability.
Yeah, I was trying to bring up that graph, but it looks like I kind of failed here, so I'm gonna go back here. But
okay, there was a question about whether you know, Grand Lake or some of these other lakes where we're talking about hand pulling, they may just not be as good of habitat for the starry stonewort, and so it may not be that hand pulling is a better management strategy. It could be that you know, it happens to a bit of applied in places where starry stonewort just isn't going to do as well. And that's a good point. And one of the real challenges for understanding starry stonewort invasion at this point is we're new to realizing we have this species in Minnesota. And when we discover it, we don't know when it got there. And so as we see tremendous variability from lake to lake in how much starry stonewort there is, And part of that is likely due to differences in habitat suitability. Some lakes are just better at growing starry stonewort than others. And some of it is likely due to differences in how long it's been there. So in some cases, maybe it's been there for years before we find it. So I think what we can tell so far based on those limited case studies is where people have found small isolated populations of starry stonewort, hand pulling can be a very targeted and effective strategy for keeping it restricted within the lake and reducing the overall abundance. But it certainly runs up against these more complicated issues of habitat suitability. And that's why it's so important. One of the lessons of Wes's analysis is that we're limited in our ability to truly evaluate management effectiveness at this point, because it is sort of so early in the process of people trying to do it systematically. And we have, sort of limited data to be able to rigorously evaluate what's working and what's not. So that's why it is so valuable, like these cases like Coronis, where there's been a really robust monitoring program, multiple years of data, measurement of untreated reference areas. And I think in general, that's a broader issue in invasive species management, certainly one we see in the aquatic realm a lot, that our monitoring is so often tied to treatment. And we have this blind spot about what's going on in areas that have been invaded but aren't being managed. And we really need data from those reference conditions to be able to tell what management is doing. There was a question also about speaking to the impact of starry stonewort on native aquatic species. And so Carly Wagner, as I mentioned, has worked on this, and she'll be wrapping up her thesis in the not too distant future. But essentially what happens with starry stonewort, it can spread quite rapidly from year to year. And it can, kind of form these dense beds or carpets, and in some conditions can really kind of start to fill the water column. And so it seems like it is, just able to sort of dominate space and displace native species. And Carly's work also suggests that the characteristics of native species with different growth characteristics are affected differently. So for example, there are native species that are sort of trying to do the same thing as starry stonewort, that have that kind of carpet forming growth on the bottom that might be more likely to be displaced from their ecological niche than species, say, white water lily that is, sort of playing a different game and is able to get above the starry stonewort in order to photosynthesize on the water surface. I think, we're asked to wrap up at about 1:50, and we're there, and I think I've managed to get through everybody's questions. So I'll thank you all again we got one more. We'll make this our final question. It's a question of whether timing of treatments has been considered as a management strategy. For example, would early season treatments be effective at keeping biomass or frequency of occurrence reduced instead of trying to treat areas later in the season after the biomass has become fully established? You want to comment on that, Wes?
Yeah, I think, this kind of butts up against kind of the limits of the data we have. And I feel like folks on Lake Coronis who've been looking at this year after year and done these repeat surveys, they're really producing data that we can look at those issues. I think in regards to the biomass, it really becomes more of a, kind of as I alluded to, kind of a nuisance management issue. So I don't think we've quite found the silver bullet to, getting rid of starry stonewort where it exists. So that's why I think, as I mentioned, those later season surveys kept that biomass down, And that is good for, again, nuisance management, recreation management. So, and I think it kind of depends on your goals, whether you'd want to try to do an early season treatment, but I don't think any evidence so far suggested that those would be effective at, eventually eradicating starry stonewort or getting it out of an area entirely. So, again, that's just kind of from the limited data we have, but we plan to kind of dive in more to these case study data that we have, and maybe we'll be able to have a little bit more accurate answer, but that's kind of my first take on that.
Yeah, and I think longer term, as we learn more and do more research, I think we'll find that timing is an important part of the equation. It's certainly been, very important for us to advance in our control of things like curly leaf pondweed and Eurasian water milfoil, of being able to sort of get the biggest bang for the buck in terms of control. And so that's where I think further work on phenology and sort of the kind of annual metabolism of starry stonewort will be valuable. Mm-hmm. Great. Well, thank you all very much. We appreciate you joining us today, and feel free to get in touch with Wes or myself if you have any follow-up questions.
Yeah, thank you to everyone.
Yeah, and I think